supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians. Cause they own my special interest groups that fund their campaign. That's why you hear the same old things they claim, but change never came. It's a dirty game maintained by rain for capital gain.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. On today's program, Giants, the Global Power Elite, the latest book by former director of Project Censored, Peter Phillips. This book is a look at the top 300 most powerful players in world capitalism who are at the controls of our economic future. Who holds the purse strings to the majority of the world's wealth? Well, there's a new global elite at the controls of our economic future. And here, Peter Phillips unveils for the general reader just who these players are, what are their plans, and what we can do about it. An hour with Peter Phillips on Giants, the Global Power Elite. Stay with us.
Unthinkable crimes perpetrated by criminal minds, political ties, habitualized alibis, disguise, another guise of democracy, politics, and the apocalypse. Got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burned bright with waves full of poison. Genocide wars fought for little boys, and the weapons manufactured paid for by taxing while the bridges and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons build the capacity citizens. In the times for the master thief, combine and conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Time's running out to reach all potential fame. At the table, then you're probably on the menu.
Welcome to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. On today's program, we welcome a very special guest. We have Dr. Peter Phillips with us, and listeners of the Project Censored Show will know that Peter Phillips is the former director of Project Censored, but he is also the co-founder of this radio program. Peter and I started this radio show back in 2010 out of KPFA in Berkeley, California. We're now on somewhere close to 50 stations between Maui and New York. And we are welcoming Peter back as a guest on the program today because his newest book is coming out from Seven Stories Press. Peter's going to talk to us about how you can get your copy of his latest book, Giants, the Global Power Elite. This book is a must-read for the general public, especially suited for community college students, university students, I would say even later high school age students. It's very important in terms of its educational value. Giants is really a much needed book for our times. Peter, in this book, shows how the global economy is shifted into the 21st century, by whom and in whose favor, and what we the people need to do to reclaim our commons, revitalizing our democratic institutions, including public education and a truly free press, redressing the ecocidal climate crisis, and restricting and redirecting the permanent wartime economy, all while creating a sustainable future with renewed human institutions that value all life and promote liberty for all, not mammon and property for the few. It's quite possible our future as a species on the planet rests in large part on how well we understand the ambitions and networks of the global power elites that Peter Phillips exposes in Giants, and whether we mobilize and act to confront them. That is my summary of Giants after looking at the early copy of it. And Peter Phillips, again, for those of you that may not know, is professor of political sociology at Sonoma State University. He's been there since 1994. He is the second director of Project Censored. He directed Project Censored between 1996 and 2010. He was president of the Media Freedom Foundation from 2003 to 2017. He teaches courses in political sociology, sociology of power, sociology of media, sociology of conspiracies, and investigative sociology. Giants, the Global Power Elite is his 18th book from Seven Stories Press in New York. Peter Phillips, welcome back to the Project Censored Show.
Mickey, it's great to be here as a guest. I did many, many shows with you over several years together, often in Berkeley, and it was a wonderful time. And I've really focused this past year on getting this book out and really trying to make that happen. And it's out and being shipped to bookstores as we talk. So we're looking at an official release date of August 21st, but it's going to be out there and available very quickly right now. And so I'm excited about it.
This is fantastic. And of course, you can go to projectcensored.org and pre-order copies now. The book will be available through the Project Censored website, and it is also available at an independent bookstore near you. You know, Noam Chomsky said of Giants, the power elite, "Who exactly are the masters? This remarkable inquiry lifts the veil, providing detailed and often shocking revelations about the astonishing concentration of private wealth and corporate power. And Peter, you had the renowned sociologist William Robinson write a fantastic introduction that really lays this out, this work that you did, Giants, the Global Power Elite. I mean, you've been studying the power elites since your days in graduate school. Tell us, what is the central theme of your study?
Well, the central theme is wealth is being concentrated and controlled by fewer and fewer people in the world. And we all know about Jeff Bezos, worth $150 billion, Bill Gates at almost $100 billion. But they're the stars. But if we look at who the real decision makers are, the ones that control trillions of dollars worth of capital, it's not these individual billionaires. It's a network of very powerful people that we call the global power elite. And they operate through a number of institutions. What we call are the giants are the investment management firms like BlackRock and Chase Manhattan Bank. They're the ones that invest other people's money for them. So like BlackRock controls $6.2 trillion worth of wealth. That's trillions. So it's a massive concentration controlled by, in that case, just 14 people on their board of directors. There's 17 giant investment management firms, and we call these the giants, that are over $1 trillion. They collectively control $41.1 trillion in 2017. It's gone up this past year. So their boards of directors are less than 199 people.
Those people fit in a room, at the university, in a lecture hall.
Exactly. I mean, it's just a small number of people. So that's part of what we're doing here is we identify them. We say who these people are. We do bios on them and that. And then there's other institutions where powerful people interact, not just on the boards of directors of these giant investment firms that are making all kinds of decisions about where to invest capital and how to expand and grow. They make all these kinds of decisions that affect all of our lives. But also there's policy institutions that are non-governmental, like the Trilateral Commission and the Council of 30 and the Atlantic Council, that are made up of global power elites who are making recommendations to governments, the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund. These recommendations are more like instructions to these institutions to take positions that support capital growth. So we have a small number of firms, small number of people controlling today probably $50 trillion worth of wealth in the world, a massive amount of the cash that's available out there. They're doing that on behalf of 35 million millionaires and 2,400 billionaires who put their money into their firms. And that's how capital is managed today in the world. They're just a single cluster of very important people, literally sucking up the profits from capital investments worldwide. That's the amazing core of what we're talking about here.
So I mentioned a moment ago, this goes back to your research on your PhD, when you wrote about the Bohemian Club of San Francisco. You've been studying elite culture, power elite culture. Of course, this is all riffing off of C. Wright Mills going back to 1956, even Dom Hoff. But you've taken this much further, and you've certainly taken it into the 21st century. We're speaking with Peter Phillips, political sociologist, his latest book, Giants on the Global Power Elite. The book goes into who rules the world. It outlines the transnational capitalist class, the power elite, and you give a 70-year history in one chapter. So you're giving us context and background. You talk about the global financial giants and the central core of global capitalism. Who are the managers of the global power elite, the financial giants? You talk about the facilitators, the power elite policy planning center of the transnational capitalist class. You then talk about the protectors, the power elite and the U.S. military, NATO empire, intelligence agencies, private military companies, and ideologists, the corporate media, public relations firms. And you talk about movements of resistance. You even have a letter to these global power elite, sort of appealing to their own sense of humanity. I just want to give listeners an idea of how much you cover in this 320-some page book. So there's an awful lot of material here. You've been researching it for years, and certainly in the last couple, you've spent most of your time working on it.
It's been really 5 years of dense data collection. And some of the chapters, I would take a whole semester with 10 students to collect the data for it. So it's a very data-rich book. Not only are the people's names in there, but then all the investment interlinks and connections that are there as well, showing this very vast network of power and capital and tightly controlled by a very, very small number of people who have the attention of nation states, capitalist nation states worldwide. They have the attention of the World Bank, the International Monetary Fund, and the WTO, all of that. They pay attention to what these folks are saying. And the U.S. government, military, and intelligence agencies work on behalf of protecting global capital and making it continue to grow. So we're talking trillions of dollars that is not talked about in business news and that kind of stuff. You get really good news about the companies, but not an awareness of how they all sociologically interact together.
Well, even in the introduction, the preface here that you have that was written by William Robinson, he even writes about his surprise. This is somebody else that's an expert in the field that was really amazed by the meticulous detail and the research that really went into this book.
I think what William Robinson was really impressed with was the idea that these 17 multi-trillion dollar giants are all invested in each other. So we looked up their NASDAQ investment relationships and showed that there's over $400 billion that is co-invested with each of the giants in each other. And then there's other, what we call near giants. These are the $800 billion investment companies, and they're all invested in each other. So all these management investment companies controlling some $70 trillion, the top 50 of them, are interconnected, have the same common goals and desires, and they all invest in Coca-Cola and Silicon Valley. So that's the direction of global capital investment. Now, the biggest problem they have is they have more capital than they've got safe places to put the money. That led to the almost near collapse of this entire system back in 2008 when they invested in the subprime mortgage things, knowing full well that those were shaky. And in some cases, they actually bet against themselves internally. But they have more capital than they've got safe place to investment. So that creates a problem. And one of the ways that governments help them deal with this problem, particularly the United States, is military spending. So wars and military spending give excess capital an opportunity to be invested in Lockheed Martin, Northrop Grumman, all the different military contractors. And they do. We actually trace how BlackRock and J.P. Morgan Chase and all of these are invested in military contractors, private military contractors. They're all invested in the media and the big media corporations. They're running the world with capital. That's what's really new here, is the degree to which this is concentrated and the very small number of people that are making the decisions about how that happens.
Well, Peter Phillips, you write in the very beginning of your book, Giants, on the global power elite, who rules the world. You say, we're living through times of dire global crisis. Social polarization worldwide has reached unprecedented levels. The figures compiled by the International Development Agency, Oxfam, are now well known. Interestingly enough, a couple years ago, that was one of the top censored stories about the concentration of global wealth. But now that's being covered in the corporate press. I think it's being covered more and more because it's becoming increasingly obvious. The richest 1% of humanity in 2017 controlled more than half of the world's wealth, you write. The top 30% of the population controlled more than 95% of global wealth, while the remaining 70% of the population had to make do with less than 5% of the world's resources. And that's only been compounded.
Well, what that means, too, is that the crisis of humanity means that the 80% of the people in the world live on less than $10 a day. And half the people in the world live on less than $2.50 a day. And 1.3 billion live on less than $1.25 a day. So this is massive poverty, gross inequality, and 30,000 a day are dying from starvation and easily curable diseases. So this is a slaughter of civilians, people all around the world, dying from hunger when we have more than enough food in the world to feed everybody. But a third of the food in the world actually gets wasted. The garbage bins outside of the supermarkets of the United States, but worldwide. There's plenty of food available to feed everybody. And we don't have a system, a capitalist system, that meets the humanitarian needs of the world population. And the second big crisis, of course, is the environmental crisis. And that is devastating. And the New York Times did a great write-up on global warming. And that's starting to be seen as dire. So it's a matter of the 3 to 4 billion people who are starving. Will they be civil unrest and riots, or will it be the downwardly mobile working class in most capitalist countries called the precariat, who are resisting the precariat in Great Britain voted out, you know, their involvement with the EU, and the precariat here in the U.S. voted in a president who's we're fairly uncomfortable with. But that happened, and that's part of the reactionary thing that they're coming from. So that creates civil unrest. It creates potential violence. And it's certainly violent to think about 30,000 people a day dying, let alone all the homeless people in this country who are just getting by and being rousted by police. And so that's what we're seeing. Robinson is very, very concerned about the increasing militarization of police systems in the world and the use of the U.S. military and NATO combined as a global police force.
We'll come back to that, because you definitely go into U.S. NATO military empire, military contractors, and more. And certainly we could talk more about this ecocidal climate crisis that we face. And in fact, it must be getting dire if the New York Times is beginning to take note.
Just last year, there were 65 million people displaced as refugees fleeing war and famine. So that number of people
and famine also caused by climate crisis.
Yes, exactly.
I'd like to remind listeners, you're tuned to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. And today we are interviewing Professor Peter Phillips. He is professor of political sociology at Sonoma State University. He's former director of Project Censored and, of course, co-founder of this program with me back in 2010. We're talking about his newest book, Giants, the Global Power Elite. We'll continue our conversation after this brief musical break. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. In studio today, we are honored to be in conversation with Professor Peter Phillips. He is professor of political sociology at Sonoma State University, former director of Project Censored. Giants, the Global Power Elites is his 18th book. You can learn more about the book at projectcensored.org. Peter, before the break, we were talking about the climate crisis and also ramped up and increased police states and militarism. And this has been a theme going back. If you go back several of the censored annual volumes that Andy Lee Roth and I have done, you had several chapters sort of teasing out some of the ideas that now have been fully developed in your new book, Giants. And of course, one of those themes, in fact, I had the pleasure and honor of co-authoring with you several pieces over the years on the U.S. NATO military empire. So can you go into a little bit more detail, not just about who are the giants, but specifically, what's this connection then to both U.S. NATO military empire, and also how does that extend into military contractors and the fact that we seem to be in a permanent warfare state?
Well, as I mentioned earlier, the big problem with the global power elite, the managers of capital, is they don't have enough places to put the money. So war is one way of siphoning off excess capital. The other way is spending investments on buying up the commons, buying up water rights and oil opportunities and all of that.
Privatizing
the world, mm-hmm. whether it's education or religion. You know, I mean, literally.
Yes.
There's a lack of concern for human betterment. There's an unrelenting quest for more capital investment. And that's the big crisis of global capitalism today. And there's a concern to protect that capital, ensure debt collection, and bring opportunities for the return. So they use every possible mechanism, every institution in the world, including the military, to protect capital growth and further the ability to have returns. So if protecting the environment is profitable, like green investment, they're going to do it. But if the services do not benefit capitalism, there's a lack of concern for the human betterment, intended or not, is the core contradiction of the transnational capitalist class today. And so that's significantly important. Now, we talked about the institutions that they use to establish their power. One of the important institutions is the G30. I call them the Executive Committee of Centralized Capital. The G30 describes itself as aims to deepen the international economic and financial issues and explore the international repercussions of decisions taken in public and private spheres. This is a highly influential institution based in Washington, D.C. It has 32 members. It's financed with over $1 million, a lot of Rockefeller monies there. But the G30 has central bankers, very important people from all over the world, who make recommendations to the International Monetary Fund or the World Bank or to governments or the central bankers around the world in terms of how the policy should be implemented and what they should be doing. These aren't just recommendations. They're seen as instructions. So this G30 group, it has 31 men and 2 women, and it's probably the central committee for the transnational capitalist class. Now, some of these people that are in it are like Jacob Finkel, who's the chair of J.P. Morgan Chase International, and he's a Ph.D. in economics from University of Chicago, longtime investment manager, international companies, number of different companies, but he's chair of the Board of Councils of Foreign Relations. He's chair of the Group of 30. He's on the Economic Advisory Board for the Federal Reserve. This man is part of the World Economic Forum, the New York Economic Club, the Aspen Institute. He's one person who's networked inside the Council of 30, but networked in a number of other policy groups around the world, who's very important. And he's one of the key players in the Council of 30. Timothy Geithner, who we remember from the Federal Reserve Board and the Treasury. He was Secretary of Treasury, U.S. Director of the International Monetary Fund. And all these people have multiple million dollars of investment kinds of capital. Jean-Claude Trichet from France, Bank for International Settlements. He's on this Council of 30. He's in the Bilderberg Group. He's on the Trilateral Commission. These are the other policy groups that are very important. We hear about more and more about Davos, the World Economic Forum. There's like 3,000 elites go there every year in January. It's the top 1,000 global corporations, over $5 billion, that can send people. They can send up to 5 individuals per company, as long as one of them is a woman. And then there's others, heads of state, people go to that. It's a kind of private, off-the-record meeting and greeting, but they don't make any policy there. There'll be some really significant speeches, and all the people in the Council of 30 have been keynote speakers at Davos, at the World Economic Forum. But there's no policy made there. It's a place like the Bohemian Grove where elite rich people get together. They shake each other's hand. They listen to talks and discussion. They mush together and drink and talk. It's kind of a celebration of being wealthy and powerful.
Of course, you've written at length about the Bohemian Grove and their ceremony.
Right.
Which is kind of symbolic of their status in the world, right? These people want for nothing.
Yeah. There's a long story there, which
right.
we don't need to go into.
Right.
But yeah. But there's no policy being made. The Bilderberg Group, the Davos groups, these are social groups where important people get together and talk about issues off the record to help try to have some understanding and consensus building, but they're not making policy. The policy is made at the Trilateral Commission, at the Council of 30. and the Atlantic Council. That's where the Atlantic Council advises security issues worldwide.
And these people are usually former heads of state, former government officials, former corporate executives.
High percentage of the people are investment capital advisors mm-hmm. on a major giant corporation mm-hmm. or have other smaller ones, you know, $100 billion in a smaller time. You will also see they're on capital advisory investment mm-hmm. boards. That's the biggest commonality besides where they went to college.
Let's open this up. You also teach sociology of conspiracies. And of course, Project Censored over the years has been, you know, accused of peddling conspiracy theory. And we know the sad and sordid history of the negative connotations of that kind of ad hominem attack stemming from the CIA in the 60s and JFK and so on. But in all seriousness, even though we shy away from using terms like conspiracy because they have such heavy baggage, right? And people immediately think of Alex Jones and how he's now being banned from social media and YouTube and so forth. Is this, in your opinion, then, looking at the denotation of the word conspiracy, not the politicized, weaponized version of it, I mean, isn't it safe or fair to suggest that these people getting together behind closed doors to plot and plan their own fiscal benefits at the expense of others, including the globe itself? I mean, couldn't that actually be described as a conspiracy of sorts, or at the very least, a business plan?
Kind of the same in some cases. We don't accuse anybody listed in our book of doing anything illegal, but these companies have, and they've been fined for it. For example, the LIBOR price-fixing
scandal
goes back to 2003. J.P. Morgan Chase, Barclays, and 13 other of the giants were implicated in this. What it was they were falsifying data used to create the benchmark rates going back to 2003, and these rates affect the price of everything from auto loans, homes, student loans, credit cards, everything. So they were manipulating the information in terms of favoring them, edging them a little bit more take. And they all knew it was happening, and they got caught. I mean, the financial services of the UK fined Barclays $450 million. J.P. Morgan Chase had to pay $360 million. Citibank paid $425 million. Deutsche Bank had to pay $2.5 billion. And there's a new one. In 2015, many of these same banks pleaded guilty to manipulating global currency exchange markets. So, yeah, they do conspire. They do get together and make arrangements, or at least some of them do, and the directors look the other way. But nobody's gone to jail over any of this. They just pay these huge fines when they get caught and say, oh, we're sorry, we won't do it again.
Until the next time.
Well, something along that line. So the word conspiracy means that people get together, and if what they're doing has some illegal activity, that's a conspiracy.
Yeah, and certainly your book outlines a lot of this kind of behavior. You're basically saying that there are reasons that economic inequality exists. There are reasons that the climate crisis has been exacerbated. Many of these companies invest in fossil fuels, energies, warfare, things that are all incredibly destructive to the planet and the climate that we all share. And again, just to round out this segment here as we cut to break, the late folk singer Peter Phillips, no relationship to Peter Phillips, once wrote that the earth is not dying, it is being killed, and those who are killing it have names and addresses. And in Giants, the global power elite, Peter Phillips gets pretty close to talking about who these people are, what, where they work. And in fact, we'll get to this later in the show, but you even have a letter, open letter, directed toward these giants, really kind of trying to appeal to their sense of humanity. So we'll certainly get to that here later on in the program. You're listening to the Project Censored Show. I am your host, Mickey Huff, and we're talking for the hour today with Professor Peter Phillips. His latest book, Giants, the Global Power Elite. Stay with us. We'll be right back. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. On today's program, we are rejoined by Dr. Peter Phillips, professor of political sociology at Sonoma State University. He's the former director of Project Censored and president of the Media Freedom Foundation from 2003 to 17, teaches courses in political sociology, sociology of power, sociology of media, sociology of conspiracy, and investigative sociology. His newest book is Giants, The Global Power Elite, from Seven Stories Press. It is his 18th book. You can find out more about it at projectcensored.org. Peter, before the break, we were certainly covering a lot of ground about what's in your latest book. Let's talk a little bit more about the global power elite and how exactly do they communicate their policy needs for military and intelligence services, and how does this get meted out, and give us maybe some tangible examples?
Let's look at the Trilateral Commission, which goes back to the 70s. It was funded by Rockefeller. Actually, when he and Brzezinski went to the Bilderberg group, they thought, well, we need to have something like this in the U.S. So they funded the Trilateral Commission. And at that time, it was called Trilateral because it was just European, U.S., and Japan. Now there's 40-some countries that are involved, 400 members. But they have an executive task force that are part of the global power elite that we identify. An example of how they'll make a policy recommendations. In 2013 and 14, the Trilateral Commission issued a report entitled Engaging Russia, A Return to Containment. And they had spent well over a year putting that together. They have staff funds and research and multiple meetings. The report expressed alarm caused by the Russian, quote, invasion of Crimea. And I put invasion in quotes there because Russia already had bases there. They didn't invade. They didn't move any new troops in. And the people there voted to leave the Ukraine because they were all Russians. But, you know, he's been accused of invading there. So the President Putin was described as bringing about a ruthless break with the West, abandoning Gorbachev's vision of Russia joining a common European home. The Trilateral Commission feels that Russia is not contributing to global security and rather aspires to superpower status. And U.S. business leaders are concerned about the anemic growth and economic climate in Russia. So, I mean, business capital is salivating over the investments that could happen there, the oil and gas and all the wealth that's available in the country of Russia. They'd really love to have greater access.
Well, it's the U.S., in fact, that moved into the Ukraine and backed neo-Nazis in Ukraine. And Joe Biden's son was placed on the board of the largest gas company there. And NATO's been encroaching ever eastward toward Russia.
Exactly. They promised Gorbachev that they wouldn't put NATO into the countries when they withdrew from Poland and the other countries. They said they wouldn't do it. Now they're all part of NATO, and increasingly so. And so Russia sees that. Putin certainly sees that. And then you can see a report like this, because it's a public report. And a quote from this report from 2014 says, in short, Russia always was and will remain different. An acceptance of the otherness should be a premise for forming our views on Russia's future and our relationships with her. Even if Moscow seeks normalization with the West, the nature of Putin's regime permits little more than a transactional U.S.-Russia relationship on a narrow range of issues. However, Putin's departure from office may produce a transformational moment that portends real systematic change in Russia. Russia politics will be reinvented from the ground up.
Like Clinton in 95 and 6 with Yeltsin, like the meddling of the U.S. in that election.
Well, they totally meddled, and Yeltsin let him invest, and we were really engaged there for a long time. And the oligarchs started to say, well, wait a minute, Putin, let's not allow this to happen. So this policy is laid out, and this is 4 or 5 years ago. And ever since, we have seen a very strong anti-Russia, anti-Putin commentaries in the media. Now they're allegedly have interfered with our election.
Well, it just runs round the clock. I mean, MSNBC, the New York Times, Washington Post, all while Trump crows about fake news. I mean, this is why that kind of weaponized term has some currency, is that these major propaganda media outlets...
It's very biased, and partly because Trump has sort of tried to put the damper on that challenge to Russia. But, you know, Russia, whatever impacts they had on the election were minor compared to, as Chomsky acknowledged, Israel.
Where Netanyahu openly comes to the Congress and gives talks. It's pretty amazing, not to mention AIPAC. And again, that's not to say that Putin and the Russian oligarchs are somehow good guys in the scenario here. It's not to suggest that this is a pro-Russian or pro-Putin narrative. It's simply saying what we're hearing in a lot of the Western press is very pro-NATO, pro-Western empire. We saw 179 Democrats from the, quote, resistance voting to approve a $717 billion military budget, right? That's what these people in the Trilateral Commission and the 30 and the rest of these groups that you're talking about, that's something that behooves their interests.
Absolutely. And it's a military budget that is global. I mean, the U.S. is operating special forces in 150 nations in the world.
Yeah, which Nick Turse writes about routinely. That was a top story,
exactly.
And now it's even more.
And NATO has been taking on a larger role. And, of course, NATO always has to have a U.S. general as the commander.
So can you talk more about that, the military contractors, you know, or the special ops? This isn't just outright wars in terms of Iraq or invade Afghanistan, where we've been for 17 years with no goal in sight.
Capital investment is in Africa. It's all over the world.
Yeah,
it wants to invest. Capital wants to be invested anywhere they can get a return. So the military, U.S. military and NATO, are there to protect and make sure that governments are cooperating with capital investment. That's the agenda for capitalism, is to be able to invest and get a return. Now, in Africa, one of the main competitors with them and doing heavy investment there is China. And we don't control China. So there's a real need to have military operations ongoing in Africa. I mean, when Gaddafi was overthrown with U.S. help and French help, it was a conspiracy to get rid of him. But partly that was because he was trying to increase monetary control there, create their own bank, start selling oil and gold, and a variety of other things. But one of the things was that the Chinese had multiple billions of dollars invested in Libya. And after the coup and the changes there, they had to withdraw. That was a major setback for them in that region. And controlling China, keeping them from growing, is a big agenda of the global capitalists.
Not that this is a perfect analogy, but I mean, look, this is not a lot different than what Alfred Mahan was talking about in the 1890s that led McKinley into trying to dismantle the Spanish Empire in the name of freedom and liberation. 83 years ago, Smedley Butler, at the time the most decorated Marine in U.S. history, called himself a gangster for capitalism. He said, we invaded these countries in Central and Latin America and made them safe for U.S. investments. I mean, he wrote that pamphlet called War is a Racket in 1935.
That history is with us, but it continues today on a global scale. So like Trump's exchange, the tariffs thing that he's doing with China and threatening China, their main objective with China is to get China to agree that U.S. companies could have 51% and ultimately 100% ownership in China. And right now they're blocked with that, but the Chinese are willing to go ahead and do that. They're even willing to go ahead and buy $200 billion more worth of U.S. products. I mean, they're open to that. But there's many other agendas there that keep blocking this. It's all about capital and capital investment. That message is clear. We're protecting our capital and the capital of the centralized capital of the world, the giants' investment opportunities, and we want it free to go into China, free to go all over Russia, but we think there has to be a regime change there and anywhere else in the world, including Iran and Cuba.
Well, we're still looking at the possible $1 trillion of mineral deposits in Afghanistan, which is likely part of the reason we haven't left there, geostrategic location, opium trade, oil to the Caspian Sea. In fact, some studies in the last couple of years have put it well over $1 trillion potentially of resources in Afghanistan. And by the way, since you mentioned AFRICOM and you mentioned the stuff that's going on right now with China and these U.S. trade wars, take a look at how we got into World War II, right? With long-standing conflicts in the Pacific with Japan over trade rights to China that ultimately had an embargo on Japan, and Japan ultimately attacked U.S. military interests in the Pacific, sparking off U.S. involvement in World War II. This is a long story that is culminating in the giants, the global power elite. And you're talking about what these strategies look like in the 21st century. You're talking about what are the major NGOs, who are the major players. And in fact, you even go down and list the fewer than 200 people that are actually then part of this giant culture.
Closer to 300.
300 total?
We list a little over 300 in the book, but that includes not only the board of directors of the 17 giants, but it also includes the Atlantic Council, Trilateral Commission, and the Council of 30. But, you know, the U.S. military will do certain things, and then there's certain things they can't do. So what we're seeing then is increased privatization of private military company, private contractors. So the second largest private employer in the world behind Walmart is G4S out of Great Britain. They're in 120 countries. They span all the continents. They work for Israel, U.S., Australia, and the big companies, Bank of America. They provide security. They manage prisons. They have mercenaries that can go into the field and kill people. So they are a major private military company. Of course, we all know about Blackwater and Eric Prince and how that was founded and all the problem they had with there. Well, they've merged. They're huge. And
Z was actually one of their names for
a while. One of their names, and they're now called Castellus Holdings, and that came into existence in 2014. They were merged with a number of others. They even have their own Air Force.
Prince left the country, arguably to avoid some kind of prosecution.
I think they're based in Dubai. But, of course, his sister is Secretary of Education, Betsy DeVos, and he's an advisor to Trump. So he's saying, well, let's do it like the British did it. Have private companies manage Afghanistan.
East Indian Company.
Yeah, exactly.
That's pretty amazing. I'm speaking with Peter Phillips. He's professor of political sociology at Sonoma State University, former director of Project Censored and co-founder of this program with me until he retired from the show last year. Peter's been busy the last several years working on research for this incredible book by Seven Stories Press. It's called Giants, the Global Power Elite. Giants is an essential tool to understand those at the reins of empire and capitalist hegemony so we can be empowered to fight for our survival. That's Abby Martin from the Empire Files on Telesword. Dr. Lawrence Shoup, author of Wall Street's Think Tank on the Trilateral Commission, says of Giants, it's a tour de force of research and analysis on a frequently ignored but crucial topic affecting humanity's future, the transnational capitalist class power elite, an extraordinary contribution. After this brief musical break, we'll complete our discussion about Giants, the global power elite, with Dr. Peter Phillips. Stay with us. Welcome back to the Project Censored Show. I'm your host, Mickey Huff. On today's program, we've been joined for the hour by Dr. Peter Phillips, professor of political sociology at Sonoma State University. He is the former director of Project Censored and former president of Media Freedom Foundation. His 18th book with Seven Stories Press out of New York is called Giants, the Global Power Elite. And you can learn more about the book at projectcensored.org or, of course, at Seven Stories Press online. Peter Phillips, we're going to conclude today's conversation, but we're going to talk maybe a little bit here about the corporate media and the role that they're playing. But I'm sure that you want to talk about what is being done to protect human rights and democracy while we're dealing with this great concentration of wealth. And we want to get back to this letter, an open letter that you've written to the giants, appealing to their sense of humanity. But before we do that, we'd surely be remiss if we didn't talk at least a little bit about corporate media, public relations, propaganda in service to the transnational capitalist class. These are things that you've written about in previous Project Censored books, also again here in Giants. So talk to us a little bit about the role that corporate media and public relations firms play in the propaganda of the power elite.
Well, global corporate media are owned and controlled by the ideologists for the global power elite. I mean, the message from corporate media today, Walt Disney, Comcast, Time Warner, Fox, is capitalism is the only way. If it just keeps growing, we're all going to get better. And it'll trickle down, everybody will be happy. And the case is quite clear that that's not happening. And that consolidation continues. So we do an analysis of each of those companies. Disney's trying to buy Fox now, and AT&T, of course, is trying to buy Time Warner, and those are pending even further mergers and consolidations of media control. And these six firms, Viacom and Bartelsmann, they control the lion's share of news around the world. I mean, anybody in the world literally is getting this ideologically tainted understanding of what's happening in the news, and they get it partly from public relations companies who are supplying the major corporate media with content. So PR firms work for governments, they work for corporations, they manage products, and they're massive. Omnicom, WPP, Interpublic Group are the three big ones, and they basically manage information for the military, for universities, states, churches, and literally every product in the world that has any advertising involved. And they will prepare news stories that will run in the corporate media. So like 80% of the news content of any daily television news show is being packaged or prepared by public relations firms in advance. So it's managed news in a very direct way. So locally, we'll get the forest fires and the accidents and murders. But when it comes to the international news or corporate news, that's packaged through a public relations firm.
That's pretty remarkable. And I know we've talked in years past about who are those groups, right? Like the Rendon Group or Hill and Knowlton, and listed very specific campaigns that they've waged in order to sell wars and sell certain stories. In fact, in both of those, in both Iraq wars, in fact. And you've certainly talked about that at length. You can learn more in Giants, The Global Power Elite. It's Peter Phillips' 18th book. But Peter, in the last part of the interview here, you, for years, when you teach and when you speak, you're speaking in New York City and Philadelphia. Coming up here, your schedule and calendar will be posted at projectcensored.org. Maybe you can say something about that at the end of the hour as well. People can catch your talk. It's certainly something that should not be missed. You always mention what is to be done, what we can do. You always appeal to our sense of humanity, our sense of justice, social justice. I know that you always in your classes talk about the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and how significant that is. Can you tie that into some of what your prescriptions are about how we address these myriad crises?
Well, there could be no doubt that continued concentration of wealth cannot be economically sustained or environmentally, for that matter. And mass movements around the world, movements like Occupy, they'll continue to emerge. And Occupy left us with the consciousness of the 99 versus the 1%, which was really important. So the global power elite identified in this book are the key stewards of major part of the world's financial wealth. They could, in fact, direct some of that wealth downward in a deliberate way of saving, so to speak, saving themselves. Because we're faced with crises of mass civil unrest, repression, wars, environmental catastrophes, all of that within young people's lifetime, certainly this century. And that can lead to chaos and complete destruction of the species. That's very possible. So we think that the power elite today, they have grandchildren, or they will, and their grandchildren will have children, and that there needs to be some deliberate direction of change. And so this isn't necessarily a revolution from the bottom up. Those social movements need to happen to pressure elites to make the changes that are vital. And if they don't make the changes, then I really am seriously worried for the survival of our planet. The real question then is, will the power elites take action to restructure capital concentration before social movements topple their capitalist regime with massive civil unrest and world war? That's the danger. That's where we stand. So whatever social movements are involved, whether it's a Bolivarian movement in South America or another Occupy-type movement here, we think that it's really important to focus on human rights as the important issue. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights was prepared 70 years ago. It took 2 years in the writing. It's a strong moral document that in Article 25 talks about everyone has a right to a standard of living adequate for health, well-being, their families, food, clothing, housing, and medical care. I couldn't agree more. And those are the kinds of human rights that we need to be standing on. Not only teaching the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which I do in every one of my classes, but making that a moral code for the direction that global elites are going and that the world social movements that are going to pressure them are going as well.
And certainly quite germane to Project Censored and the themes that we've addressed over the years. And certainly you repeatedly, while you were director of the project, invoked Article 19. Everyone has the right to freedom of opinion and expression. This right includes freedom to hold opinions without interference and to seek, receive, and impart information and ideas through any media and regardless of frontiers. In fact, it's the very kind of information and research and analysis, Peter Phillips, that you compiled and offered in Giants on the Power Elite that is subject to global censorship.
We'll see.
Certainly, we're trying our best to get the message out, and I know you've been on a lot of programs, and you are getting a hearing, and Seven Stories Press is behind it. I know Dan Simon has written very favorably of the text, and it's coming out here very shortly. By the time this program airs, folks should be able to find it. You can pre-order at projectcensored.org. Again, Noam Chomsky says, Adam Smith warned that the masters of mankind will pursue their vile maxim, all for ourselves and nothing for other people. There could hardly be a more apt description of the recent era of savage capitalism, straining for new heights under cover of Trump's antics. Who exactly are the masters? Well, of course, Peter Phillips, in your book, you tell us about the masters. You tell us who they are. You tell us what their networks are. You tell us how they operate. You tell us how the global power elite help give instruction through U.S. NATO military empire, through the military-industrial complex and intelligence services, private military contractors, public relations firms, and the corporate media. And, of course, you also tell us what can be done. Last words, what impelled you to write that very personal kind of letter that you have where you're appealing to these very people who are kind of untouchable? Not even the Jeff Bezos or the Bill Gates, the celebrity of the giant elites, but the people that we never hear of. You had a very heartfelt appeal to them because you still believe in humanity and you believe that these people have families and they have loved ones. And
some of them, like Jamie Dimon and Larry Fink, manage the two largest investment firms in New York City, recognize that there are humanitarian issues involved, but they absolutely believe the market is going to solve everything. Well, they're wrong. And I think this book very clearly shows that that's wrong and that we're facing dire consequences in very major ways, catastrophes for the world, if this capital concentration continues and they don't make some adjustments, like a 1% tax on all investments that goes directly to the poorest people in the world or something along those lines. I mean, they're going to have to figure it out. We don't have any prescriptions. But I'm not ready to arm myself and join the barricades in the hopes that we'll overthrow this without destroying the world. I mean, that is what is concerning to me, is that there will be room for my grandchildren and all of ours to have a way of life that's sustainable in this society. So we have a letter signed by 90 people. You're one of them, and many others, my friends and associates and professors and people all over the world, signed this letter to the power elite saying you've been identified in this book as part of the global power elite. We think you ought to think about that and make some changes. It's not sustainable. You can't keep going the way you're going and keep the world intact. And so we've been very clear about that. The letter's very upfront. So I'm hoping to build an awareness among them, as well as the 99% of the people in the world who have access to this information. Certainly the social movement activists of the world should know who they're up against. And this is identifying those people individually.
Well, Peter Phillips, Giants is an interdisciplinary tour de force and expose. It uniquely catalogs and traces the global power elites of the transnational capitalist class, while also analyzing their increasingly vast reach into all corners of the world and all aspects of our lives. Of course, your work at Project Censored over the years also addressed these great issues, but your political sociologist background, right, helps break down the political economy of late capitalism's concentrated wealth, noting the looming consequences and what is to be done. Again, including naming the names and outing the networks of the new global power elite and even asking them to do their share to reverse power dynamics in a way that reflects a more just, democratic, and representative society for all before it's too late. Our guest today has been Professor Peter Phillips. His latest book is Giants, the Global Power Elite. Get your copy today. You can learn more at Seven Stories Press or at projectcensored.org. Peter Phillips, thank you so much for coming back on the Project Censored show today.
Well, thank you so much. And I'd like to remind our New York friends that I will be in New York August 16th for a reception and presentation and talk for the release event of Giants, the Global Power Elite, hosted by Seven Stories Press. The event will be at Fordham University Midtown at Martino Hall on the 7th floor. And this is August 16th, Thursday, 6 p.m. reception, 7 p.m. talk and presentation. We hope you all can attend.
Thanks very much.
Supporting human conditions, not free market propaganda and corrupt politicians, because they own by special interest groups.
That does it for another episode of the Project Censored Show. We've been speaking with Peter Phillips about Giants, the Global Power Elite. The Project Censored Show was established in 2010 by myself and Peter Phillips. I am the executive producer and host of the program with co-host Chase Palmieri. Anthony Fest is our senior producer. Our associate producers are Dennis Murphy and Mitch Scorza. The Project Censored Show airs on over 40 stations around the United States, from Maui to New York. To learn more about our work or to find any of our previous archive programs, go to www.projectcensored.org/radio. Please follow and like us on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram at Project Censored. Please feel free to share your feedback about our work at projectcensored.org. And last but not least, thanks to you, our listeners, for tuning in. We'll see you next time.
Crimes perpetrated by criminal minds, political ties, habitualized alibis, disguised under the guise of democracy, politics, and the apocalypse. Got the skies looking ominous. So the ocean burned bright with waves full of poison. Genocide wars fought for little boys, and the weapons manufactured paid for by attacks upon the bridges and the levees and the mines collapsing. All the prisons filled with capacity citizens. And the times for the master thief, combine and conquer, steal a masterpiece. Open your eyes and realize what's happening. Time's running out to reach all potential fame at the table, then you